Anyway, I wanted to say a few words about Dick Mann. Most of us, many of us, went to his service just a couple of days ago. Dick Mann was 6 years my senior, and he was kind of my hero. We had a few things in common. One, he flew the Wildcat before he flew the Hellcat in 1944. I flew the Wildcat 50 years later, and we talked about it. And he also gave me his tailbone magazines after he read them, and I passed them on to my son, Mike, who would read them and then pass them on to his friends. So I remember Dick quite well. He sat at the table next to us. So we just lost another World War II vet. Today I want to talk about, I was cleaning out one of my foot lockers, and I ran across a magazine, aviation magazine, dated October 1939, almost 80 years ago. In the magazine was an article about Pan Am Boeing Clippers, the flying boats. So I thought it was interesting, and I thought I'd talk a little bit about the Trans-Pacific Clippers. It was written by a captain who made a flight in 1939. He would now be 117 years old, so I didn't try to get a hold of him. I didn't think it would be worthwhile. In the article, he talks about his 1939 flight from San Francisco to Hong Kong, China, in a Boeing 7 and a Boeing 314 Clipper flying boat. If you look at this board up here, flying boat, was the latest model of the Boeing Clipper. There were 12 of them built, and they flew from 1938 to 1941, this captain did. They had crew of 12, 11 or 12, carried 74 passengers, with 36 provided for beds. The payload was 10,000 pounds, the length 106 feet, wingspan 152 feet, a height of 20 feet, empty weight was 48,000 pounds, loaded 84,000 pounds. It had four Wright R2600 engines of 1,600 horsepower each. The listed max speed is 180 knots with speed and dive, excuse me. The listed cruise 163, but more like about 145, 150. The range was 3,200 feet.
Miles, not feet. Range.
I'm glad you're paying attention, Dick. 3,200 nautical miles. The ceiling was 19,000 feet. We'll go along with that. Good. This flight that he talks about in the magazine with 77 passengers and 10 flight crew members. There was the captain, the first officer, second officer, navigator, who was also a pilot, two radio operators, two flight engineers, and numerous cabin crew. The flight engineers could actually climb out in the wing through a tunnel to work on the engines, do a little repair, or just check motor. The captain and the flight deck, I'm going to pass this around. Take a look at this flight deck. It's more like a ship than an aircraft. The captain actually had an office that he had used for his private business, maintaining the ship's log and talking to crew members. The flight would take 16.5 hours to reach Honolulu, 10 hours to Midway, 10 hours to Wake Island, 10 hours to Guam, 10 hours to Manila, and another 10 hours to Hong Kong on that flight. The crew and passengers with RON at each stop required up to 7 days and 70 hours of flight time to reach Hong Kong. Flying on the Pan Am Clippers, was much different than international flights that we experience today. Customs at the time followed what was standard on ocean-going vessels and was adopted on the Clippers. The entire crew for this weekly flight, they ran about every week, would receive a thorough pre-departure physical exam. The aircraft was given a complete mechanical check, including a 2-hour flight check, the day before the scheduled flight. After takeoff on a water runway, when we say runway, we kind of think hard surface, but we have snow runways, sod runways, asphalt runways, concrete runways, and water runways. Required about 10,000 feet to get airborne. After a night takeoff and reaching the cruising altitude of around 7,000 feet there, the captain would turn over control of the aircraft to the first officer and go downstairs. He said they referred to it as downstairs to have a dinner with 14 first class passengers. The 7-course dinner was served on a white linen tablecloth and fine crystal. Before the captain took his seat, he would be introduced to the 14 passengers by one of the purser's. He'd go around and shake their hand, say a few words, and then have dinner. Later, the captain would return to the flight deck, and the first officer would join a second group for a sit-down dinner downstairs. At each en route stop, the crew and passengers were provided with first-class accommodations, transportation, dinner, and breakfast at each stop. En route, the radio operators would communicate with ocean vessels, obtain the latest world news, and if passengers wished, they would send a message by tapping a code in Morse code. 36 passengers could reserve a comfortable bed, and a private honeymoon suite was available in the back of the aircraft, allowing certain people to experience the Mile High Club. Maybe not know what the Mile High Club is, but the honeymooners knew what it was. The fare from San Francisco to Hong Kong was $950. Wow. That's equal to $17,000 today.
Yeah.
That may seem like a pretty high, but keep in mind that each passenger was provided accommodations, transportation, lodging, meals on land and in the air for almost 7 days. The crew, after reaching Hong Kong, would have 2 days off before returning to San Francisco, utilizing the same route. When returning home, they would have been gone for almost 2 weeks and could expect 2 weeks off before making another flight. The captain's pay at that time was $833 per month. That's equal to $15,000 or $180,000 a year today, which is pretty standard. My son doesn't make quite that much.
Not quite. About $160,000?
Yeah. But on the road, remember they were gone for 2 weeks. The crew, when they're on the road, they didn't have to spend a penny unless they bought gifts. Everything was paid for by the airline. Pan Am Clipper service flights were nationally interrupted during World War II.
Yeah, right.
Or should we say World War II?
Yeah, okay.
World War II, I like that. The last flight of a Clipper was in 1946. This is talking, I'm talking about the Boeing service in the Pacific. The aircraft had anti-ice boots on the tail and wings. It wasn't pressurized, but it had airflow and heat, so it was pretty comfortable. And they flew to the South America, to Europe, not to Alaska. But I just thought it was interesting when I read this article. Now, a magazine that I bought when I was 11 years old, which was a long time ago. If anybody has any questions, I did a fair amount of research on the Clippers. Yeah.
Sure, it had autopilot, didn't it?
Oh, yes, it had autopilot, absolutely. Yeah.
It wasn't pressurized. How did it fly with passengers at 19,000 feet?
It did not fly with passengers at 19,000 feet. That was the service ceiling of the aircraft. They normally, like the flight this captain talks about, he started out at 7,000 feet. They generally did not like to go above 10,000 feet. So it was heated, and even at 7,000, 8,000 feet, it was pretty cool. But they did not fly a high altitude for passengers. That's the service ceiling of the aircraft itself. If you look at the picture of the aircraft, you can almost see the B-17, the wings and the engines. Didn't require much change to make the bomber B-17 out of it. Any other questions? Yes.
How many airplanes were produced?
The 314 was the latest model. They produced 12 aircraft. Three of them went to BOAC. And Pan Am operated 9. Two of them crashed with some fatalities. The others just, again, World War XI interrupted the service. So they flew mainly from the U.S. to Honolulu, and later to Yacha.
How much of the plane itself was made out of wood?
Just the furniture inside.
The skin was metal?
It was all metal. Why did they have ships to land and take off on water in that day? Several reasons. One, a land aircraft that would take off on land, they needed a long runway. Even if the B-17 were on 7,000 feet could operate. But an aircraft of this weight, with the engines available, they need a long runway. When we say runway, again, we think of hard service. But a runway can be water, which it was. And they could make a takeoff at night, but they had to land, that was their requirement, on daylight. At night, they would have some boats and floating pots to mark the runway. Take them about 10,000 feet to get off the ground, or get off the water. Yeah, great.
Any idea how much fuel they carried?
Yeah, they carried a lot. But as I recall, around 3,200 gallons, something like that. But the range of 3,200 nautical miles.
Could they land on land if they had
to? Only in an dire emergency.
Yeah.
Yeah, again, another reason they had a flying boat, because almost all their flights, international flights, were over water. So in case they lost a couple of engines, they could land in the water with the boat, which they couldn't on a land airplane. So that was another reason in that stage of production that they used a flying boat instead of an aircraft here. Later on, of course, the engines were perfected and more reliable. They could overcome that. Weather was quite critical for these flying boats, because of the takeoff and landing. And now, They had a protected water area in near San Francisco. Protected water area in Honolulu. Midway Island, Wake Island, Guam, they land close to the shore. And then they had a protected area in the Manila and also Hong Kong. So they had to be very careful about large swells and the sea condition to land. So they really checked the weather over very carefully. A lot of their flights were delayed because of sea conditions. Gotcha.
And taxiing in the water, did they have any special control or do they have just use the engines and rudders?
They just used the engines.
PBM, we had a sea anchor, had it throw on either side.
Well, they had an anchor in the nose and a rope. And they were a boat, so they would taxi up close to shore, shut down the engine, and be towed in to port. And when they were ready to launch, they'd be shoved out like a ship, away from the dock area, and start the engines and then taxi out. They use differential power for control, which some of the smaller aircraft you don't have.
The late P-5M Martin had little controls at the end of the hull to turn.
Well, Boeing was in competition with Sikorsky and Martin. Martin made a flying boat very similar to the Boeing, but the Boeing was more successful. John, you had a question? Other than how long I'm going to talk.
Historical observation. My understanding is that once that aircraft was launched and was flying, that the Japanese were frequent flyers, and probably about two-thirds of them were aeronautical engineers and picture takers. And then they came out with two models. One was the Kawanishi, which was almost an exact duplicate of this model, and then they made another one that was slightly higher powered, and I can't remember the name of that one. End of history observation.
Yeah, according to the articles that I read, and if you want to do a Google search on flying boats, there's a lot of information on the internet. This one, Google sailplane flying boats. You get a lot of information. But reports that I read, the pilots liked flying this. It was said it was easy to control. Of course, they didn't have to do very steep maneuvers, but they said it was easy to fly. And surprisingly, they talked about it being quiet. Apparently, the engines were far enough away from the main dining room that it was quiet enough for them to sit at the dining table and carry on a conversation. They talk about that. That was kind of surprising. Yeah, Jim.
You didn't mention anything about the navigation that they used, though. Was that good?
Well, they use celestial, of course.
Yeah.
Then they use DF steers. When they leave San Francisco, they'd get DF fixes about halfway to Honolulu. Get a coordinate heading, and they plot it on the chart. But then he had a point of no return where they had to figure where if they had a problem, they could either go back to San Francisco or continue on to Honolulu. Get about halfway to Honolulu, they'd get DF fixes from Honolulu and then draw them on a chart. Look at this when I pass around. They had the cockpit is really, it looked like a living room.
Were they ever used in combat? Did they have the guns and bombs?
No, they didn't. It's, again, World War XI interrupted everything. And for a long time, they flew just from San Francisco to Honolulu, and then later to Wake as the war progressed in Guam. But it was never armed. And again, they only built 12 of the 314, which is the most advanced. Yes? that was the cost for the ticket at that time.
Right, what did they charge for a ticket for a passenger?
That's what they charged.
$800?
$800. When I get into the inflation calculator.
Well, you said 900.
950, thanks, I'm paying attention. Yeah. The fare was $950 in 1938. I went into an adjusted for inflation calculator, and it comes out to 17,000 today. But again, remember this 900, if you're a passenger and spent $950, that included all the stops en route, transportation, lodging, dinner, breakfast, and food on the aircraft. That's all you have to spend. So 17,000 when adjusted for inflation sounds high, but I guess actually what you were provided is not too bad. Yeah, Raj.
How did this compare with the blue, with the Spruce Goose of Howard Hughes?
Well, the Spruce Goose just made one flight of about 40 feet.
Yes.
The Spruce Goose had 10 engines.
It's bigger.
Bigger, of course, longer under power. And they came out with the 314. Five minutes to 1. Any other questions? All right, thanks, guys.
Thanks,
you guys next week.
Okay.
Thank you for good program.
I had a couple of issues.